light. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it, with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord.
Morning, everyone. I want you to think about what you typically watch, what movies you watch this time of year. For the Milroys, we tend to watch a lot of Christmas movies, and that is, it's not true of everyone. We had our youth hangout last Friday night, and they watched the movie Elf, and there were a couple people, including the youth leader himself, who had never seen Elf. God, can you really be an American and not, like, have seen this movie? So, one of my favorites is a movie about, it's ultimately about something called nostalgia, like thinking back to a time when you were joyful, a time past that you kind of wish you could go back to because it was so joyful. And it's about this guy's favorite Christmas gift that he'd ever gotten in his life. And some of you might know what this Christmas gift is by heart, and you can feel free to say it with me if you want, okay? A Red Ryder carbine action 200-shot range model air rifle. Ralphie is trying to get that. He's told he'll shoot his eye out over and over, and he finally gets it, and this is him sizing up the bad guys in his imagination. And so I want you to think about what your favorite Christmas gift was that you ever received in your life, okay? And in the first service, somebody blurted out Jesus, which, of course, you know, that's the answer. But besides Jesus, okay, we'll get to him in a minute, but for now, the material gift, that your favorite gift that you've ever received, and I want you to tell your neighbor what that gift was right now. Go ahead. All right. So I hope what that did, I'll tell you mine, okay? I'm going to show you mine. This was I don't know if this is familiar to anybody. It's a Darth Vader carrying case of Star Wars figures. And I would carry that thing around, and I would play with them all the time. And I still remember this. I remember when I found a mangled and beheaded Boba Fett because I left him in the yard, and my dad mowed him. And it was a terrible moment for me. But I remember the time when I was that age, and I have very fond memories of that time in my life. And you may not. You may not have had a great family life. You may not think back to those moments with a lot of joy, but you probably have some times in your life past that you think back on and you think of fondly. We're in this series called The Promised One, and we're looking at four different prophecies about Jesus as we're leading into the celebration of his birth. And this morning, the passage is about joy. Joy that we have available to us as followers of Christ. If you are a follower of Christ, you have this inexhaustible reserve of joy. And some of that joy might be characterized by looking back at a time that was joyful. And I think for all of us, when we look back at times and we're kind of struck by this pang that we wish that we were there and we remember it fondly, that is actually a remembering of the Garden of Eden. That in some sense it connects with a world that has passed without sin. And also we anticipate. This is a great time of anticipation. The kids anticipated so much the coming of the celebration of Christmas and the time, the family time and the worship and the presents and all of that. There is a joy that we anticipate that looks forward to the future. All of us are given access to an inexhaustible reserve of joy, no matter who you are, no matter what you're going through. And so I want to see that in the text this morning, a wonderful text that we often read on Christmas Eve, Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 7, a prophecy about the coming Messiah. So let's pray first, and then we'll take a look at this text. Father God, we thank you so much for the promised one, Jesus. We thank you that we are gathered in his name, and that you have actually given us incredible, undefeatable joy that we have in the midst of our stressful and busy lives that we can actually take hold of. And Lord, we want to pray this morning for those who are grieving, who are hurting. There are, as we saw in the prayer request last week, there are many people who are going through very hard times, and we pray for them. We pray in particular for Jamie McNabb, a member of our church and firefighter who is in the hospital because of doing his job, and we pray for his healing. And we pray that you would bless Lynn, and we pray for Riley and Grant as well. We pray for the McNabb family. Lord, as we turn to your word, we pray that you would give us wisdom. We pray that you would send your Holy Spirit so that we can learn what the text means in our time. This text written 2,700 years ago. What does it mean for us today? We pray that you would make that clear, that we would apply it to our lives, and that we would shine the light of Christ in the world more faithfully and more joyfully. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want to look at the first verse in Isaiah 9. Pull out your bulletin and you can read along. But there is light in the dark that Isaiah is talking about in chapter 9, verse 2. It says, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone." The light that Jesus brings to the world changes everything. And Isaiah sees it. Somehow the Holy Spirit imparts to him this blessing of prophecy where he is looking forward to the time when Jesus will come. And this is a very well-known metaphor in our lives. We use it today, and it's used all throughout the Bible, light and darkness. If you have been kept in the dark about something, what does that mean? It means you don't know. And some of you seem to be in the dark about what it means to be in the dark. It means you don't know what's coming, and you were not told whatever it is. Conversely, if someone has seen the light, what does that mean? It means you do know. It means you've been shown what, and often, you know, wives tell their husbands, "You finally seen the light," and that usually means you agree with my opinion now. So when you've seen the light, so we use this language, literally it's used in the Bible to represent the very dawn of creation in Genesis 1, verses 3 and 4. It says, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw that the light was good." And so from that time on, light represents that which is good, and darkness often represents that which is evil. And the same is true here. It says, "The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light." And then look at the first part of verse 3. It says, "You have multiplied the nation." And what that means is that the Messiah is going to bring something that is available to more than just the Jewish people. The nation will be multiplied exponentially. And this theme also of light to the nations, and that includes all of us, is very prominent in Isaiah as well. Isaiah chapter 42 says, "I am the Lord, I have called you in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and keep you. I will give you as a covenant for the people, a light for the nations to open the eyes that are blind." And then in Isaiah 49, "I will make you as a light for the nations that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth." So Jesus is that light. And when he comes into the world, the disciple who is loved, that's how he calls himself, the disciple whom Jesus loved, John, the fourth biography of Jesus in the New Testament, this is what it says: the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And that is the message of Christianity. It is that there is now light in the darkness that is our life. But it is also an implicit judgment. If you do not know who Jesus is, and you're curious, maybe you're newer here and you haven't understood fully what the Christian message is, no judgment there, but I do want to tell you what the message is. The message is that the relationship that we are offered with God is light for us. And we are in the dark because apart from Jesus, we have no relationship with God. And so Jesus comes into the world to bring light. But if you don't acknowledge that you are in the dark apart from Jesus, then you can't have the light. You have to admit that you're in the dark. And so every one of us, apart from Christ, is in fact in the dark, stumbling around and unable to understand what we ought to do with our lives. Think about it. In our world, the wisdom of this dark world is that pride is a good thing. You ought to take pride in who you are. And you ought to think really, really highly of yourself. That's what the world tells us. The world tells us that lust is a natural emotion and we ought to cultivate it. The world tells us that greed is not that bad and that you've earned it and you deserve whatever you get. You come into the light. God lays low all of those things. The gospel tells us that pride is actually the number one sin that undergirds every sin. It is that which sets itself up against God and says, you know what, God, I know better than you, and I'm going to do things my way. That's pride. We don't want pride anymore when we're in the light. We want humility. We want to listen to what God tells us. The Bible tells, Jesus tells us, that we ought to be pure, not filled with lust. And so we repent of lust and we follow the way that the Bible tells us that we are not our own anymore when we belong to Jesus, and that we are to honor Christ with our bodies. The Bible tells us that we are to be generous with what we have, not greedy. And so you see how when we are in the darkness, we have a completely different understanding of what is good and what is bad, and then we come to Christ. And he completely brings us into the light. The light hurts when you get into it, but we all need it. And sometimes it's blinding, but we need it. If you want the light, then you have to admit that you're in the dark. And you have to admit that the only way out is through the cross and the resurrection of Jesus. Amen? And when you do come to Christ, then he forgives you. That doesn't mean you don't struggle with pride or lust or greed or any number of other sins, but it does mean that you are forgiven. And that you are, God is immensely patient with you, and he just wants you to keep going further and further into the light. The light of the world is Jesus. And now, as Christians, what we do is we interpret everything by the light of Christ. It's not just that he's the light, it's that everything else is illumined. We understand everything else by what Jesus says. That's kind of how C.S. Lewis puts it right here. He says, I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it, I see everything else. Does that make sense? Like now as Christians, we understand everything about our lives in light of Christ. I want to ask you if that's true of you in your life. Do you understand everything that you do in light of Christ, in light of the gospel? Do you work your job as though Jesus is Lord and you're working for him? Do you go to school and play your sport? Jesus is Lord and you're trying to do whatever you can to bring him glory. I heard a great quote by C.J. Stroud. Did you see this quote just a couple weeks ago? He's having a great year, and what did he said? Like, it's a platform for the gospel. And I'm a football player, but I really want people to know Jesus. That's an incredible thing for a young man to say who has that much of a spotlight on him. So all of us, no matter who we are, we do it in obscurity, most of us, but we do it for the sake of Christ and so that the light might shine in and through our lives. And to acknowledge the light is to experience this world, present joy. And that's what verses 3 through 6 say. Verse 3, it says, you have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy as they rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. Joy at the harvest, you know, the harvest comes in and you have a feast. Dividing the spoil, that's when you're a warrior and you win a victory. And then you receive the spoils of war. And these are metaphors of the great joy of the light breaking into the world, of the nation being multiplied. That means more and more people coming to Christ. And that's happening in the world. It's happening in places like China and Africa. It's happening less and less in America, sadly. But it is happening here. Next Sunday, we're going to have two baptisms. And these are representative of what we hope to see happen by God's grace in our church. The first baptism is a boy. He's 7 years old. His name's Jeffrey. And I met with him on Thursday to talk about his faith. And it was just me and him. And he came in and he was just fired up. And he told me about Jesus. And he told me that he had this dream that, like he said, I believe in Jesus. And then I had this dream and Jesus told me that he wants me to love him more. And so I love him more. And I'm ready to be baptized. I praise God for that. And then next, so that'll be at the first service, at the acoustic service. There's a young man, his name's Trey, and Trey's with us this morning, actually, and we met him 5 years ago or so through FBA at Lyndon McKinley High School, and he told me he was going down a path that was really bad, and these guys, Jason and Patrick and Andy started hanging out with him and just shining the light of Christ. And he just last Sunday repented of sin and trusted in Christ.
Yeah. Praise God for that.
Give Trey a hug on the way out, Trey. You better put your hand up and wave to everybody. There you go. So the gospel is going forth. Amen. And it multiplies joy. There is nothing more joyful than seeing. You know what the Bible says about this when people come to know Christ? That there's a party in heaven. Luke 15, angels rejoice when one sinner repents. And that brings tremendous this world joy. It goes on and it says, the yoke of his burden, the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken. Those are metaphors of an enemy army. And who is our great enemy? Well, Satan. And who has crushed his head at the cross? Jesus has. So we rejoice that our great enemy has been defeated. And though the enemy might harass us, might take great stuff away in this life, might kill us, he can't take away our souls. Our souls are safe. If you are in Christ, nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That is cause for rejoicing. And it says, you've broken it as on the day of Midian. Does anybody know what Midian is? Kind of an obscure Old Testament reference. Midian was a nation that warred against God's people. And Midian brought about Gideon. And it's kind of cool because it rhymes. So Midian was attacking Israel. Every time they had their crops ready to harvest, the Midianites would come in. And the Israelites, the God's people, they were really weak. And they would hide in caves. And the Midianites would come in and pillage and take all their stuff and leave. And so they cried out to God for help. And God sends the most unlikely redeemer. His name's Gideon. He's the runt of his family, and his family is a part of the runt of the tribes of Israel, the smallest tribe of Israel. And Gideon becomes this leader. He's a judge, and he leads the men of Israel into battle. There's 22,000 of them. They're facing many more warriors, Midianites. And as they're going, God tells Gideon, he says, you know what? 22,000? Way too many. If you guys win, you're going to think you did it. So you're going to do this. You're going to tell everybody, all these men who are about to like fight for their lives, if anybody's scared, they can leave. So Gideon says, all right, anybody scared? You can leave. 12,000 men leave. They're down to 10,000. Fighting tens of thousands. So they keep going, and God's like, still too many. So here's what's going to happen. When you come to this stream, you're going to see how the men drink the water, okay? You're going to divide them into two groups. Some of the men are going to go like this, scoop water, lap it up in their hands. Others are going to get on their hands and knees and drink directly from the stream. So that happens. 300 get it in their hands and lap it up, and the others get down on their hands and knees and drink it. Those 9,700 are dismissed from the army. There's 300 left. And who gets the victory? God gets the victory, because 300 could never defeat that many warriors that have been defeating Israel the whole time. In the same way, Jesus, one man, deals with the sins of billions of those who call upon his name for salvation. That's incredible. It's impossible. But all things are possible with God. Amen? Jesus rescues us in the most unlikely of ways, just like God has broken the Midianites on the day of Midian. He goes on, every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult, every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. That means that our battle has been won by Christ. And then it says to us, who is this Savior, this Messiah? To us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. Do you know what that means, Wonderful Counselor? It means that Jesus and his word can be trusted. If you need advice, go to Jesus. Go to his word and go to people who also trust in Jesus. Don't go to people who do not understand the light of the world. Okay? Go to people who go to God's word. You young people, if you have a difficult decision that you're going to make, please consult God's word. Please consult God's people. And that doesn't mean that there's no good advice out in the world. I'm not saying that, but I am saying that if you want to know how to live your life, you want to go to the Wonderful Counselor. Old people, that's true for you as well. Okay? He's a Wonderful Counselor. He's the Mighty God. That means he can do anything that he wills. He is the Everlasting Father. This one's confusing because we know God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Three persons, one God. This is not a confusion of the persons of the Trinity. Everlasting Father is just another phrase for a king, a protector, a benefactor who watches over you, who can be trusted. That's Jesus. And he is the Prince of Peace. He is all of these. He brings peace to us even when we are anxious, even in difficult situations. That's who Jesus is. And all of that brings joy. Amen? Does that bring joy to us, church? It does. Here's a definition of joy. This is John Piper, famous writer and preacher. This is how he put it. Christian joy. It's a good feeling in the soul produced by the Holy Spirit. So, a feeling. You know, we tend to be a little mistrustful of feelings, and we should be, because in our world, in our day, it's a very bizarre world where people say that your feelings define who you are, and we don't believe that. Nevertheless, we do have feelings, and we embrace those feelings of happiness that are in our soul, those deep feelings of happiness and joy. They are a gift from the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see the beauty of Christ in the Word and in the world. In the world, look around you, and you will see thousands of gifts, thousands of ways that Christ is glorified. You see it in the gathered body of Christ worshiping. You see it in the fact that some of you are college students who have just finished your finals. Don't feel relieved. I have nostalgia of being done with finals and having absolutely zero responsibility for 3 weeks in a row. That was awesome. Some of you feel that way. That's a gift. That's Christ in the world. Gathering of family, presents at Christmas, the tree, the lights, all of those are bourbon, if you're of age. Last Sunday, did somebody clap? I thought I heard somebody clap. Last Sunday, the choir gave us this amazing presentation. It was worship service Sunday night. It was wonderful. Afterwards, there was a reception, and there were cookies. And Marilyn Townsend is a member of our church, and she's more mature by her own admission. She is on the 18th green of life, is how she puts it. She made like 500 cookies, and she is the single best cookie maker I've ever met. With, you know, no offense to anyone in this room. And there were, hear this, leftovers. And they went directly to the church office. And for the next 4 days, there were cookies. That's a gift, and it displays Christ in the world. All of these gifts display Christ. And so does the Word of God, where we find these promises that we can rejoice in all circumstances. That means if we are feeling really low and grieved, it doesn't mean we'll be happy all the time. It does mean that there is cause for rejoicing because we know what happens in the end. Amen? It means we know that in all things, God is working out for the good for those who love Him. It means we know that God will never leave us or forsake us. In His Word, we find incredible promises for our mission in life, our purpose in life. We have all these amazing things in the Word of God, and they shine the light of Christ, and they show the beauty of Christ in the world. And that is why, brothers and sisters, you and I should have tremendous joy. In this time of year, we should have particular joy. G.K. Chesterton, some of you know who that is, he was a prolific writer, wrote over 100 books, lived in the 18 and 1900s, around the turn of the century, an immense man, a man of I don't know, he just was an excessively joyful Christian at 6'4", 300 pounds, okay? And this is what he wrote about Christmas. He said this: "It may be because I am silly, but I rather think that relatively to the rest of the year, I enjoy Christmas more than I did when I was a child. My faith demands that such be the case. The more mature I become, the more I need to embrace the joys of the incarnation. The more mature I become, the more I need to be the child. And the joys that we have in Christ are such that we become not childish, but that we become childlike because there is so much to rejoice in." Amen? And that present joy looks forward to a future joy. Verse 7, "of the increase of His government and of peace that will be no end." This is looking forward. Jesus is already on His throne, brothers and sisters, but He's going to return and He's going to vanquish evil forever. He's going to throw Satan in the lake of fire where he will remain forever and all evil will be wiped off the map. On the throne of David and over His kingdom, He will establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. We look forward to that time. And nostalgia is looking back to a time where we feel tremendous, like we long for that time. I don't know when it was for you. For me, I have a lot of happy memories as a child because I had amazing parents. And you may not, but you may look back to some time when you were happy, when you were little. There's a pang there, like a feeling like, oh, I wish I could be there. I missed that time. And that, I think, looks back to the Garden of Eden, brothers and sisters. Because if we actually went back to that time, you weren't joyful 100% of the time. You still had issues then. We live in a fallen world. But we're looking back to the garden. And when we anticipate Christmas Eve and all the joy of being together and celebrating, we're actually looking forward to the time when Jesus will return and we will feast with Him forever. And that future joy ought to fuel our present joy. There's a great description of this joy in a book that I love. It's The Lord of the Rings, and at the end of it, there are two guys. If you're not familiar with the story, Frodo and Sam are the two main characters, and they have this terrible task of going to in the heart of the realm of this evil lord and destroying this ring. And against all odds, they get there, and it takes their very last gasp, and they destroy the ring, and they're this close to dying, and they slip into unconsciousness. And they don't even know it, but they're rescued, and they're taken to all of their friends, and this glorious victory, and they wake up, and this is what it says, and this points to the feast that is coming for all of us who are in Christ. It says, "Sam laughed aloud for sheer delight, and he stood up and cried, 'Oh, great glory and splendor, and all my wishes have come true.' And then he wept, and all of his friends laughed and wept. And in the midst of their merriment and tears, the clear voice of the singers rose like silver and gold, and all men were hushed. And they sang to them until their hearts, wounded with sweet words, overflowed, and their joy was like swords. And they passed in thought out to regions where pain and delight flow together,
and hears of the very wine of blessedness. That is what awaits us, brothers and sisters. The feast where joy will go ever, ever more deeply. And that fuels our desire to be faithful to Christ, to shine His light in the here and now. And I want you to take one of these cards. If you want to apply this message, one way you can do that is by taking one of these cards with you as you leave and giving it to someone to invite them to a Christmas Eve service, because we are going to share the gospel. And it might just be, if the Holy Spirit desires to do so, that others might be drawn into this eternal joy, that others might leave the darkness and come to the light and come to Christ, because you and I, we were created for joy. And if you are not feeling particularly joyful right now, if you're anxious, if you're sad, if you're grieving, then I don't want you to feel guilty, but I want you to know that the Bible tells us that the joy of the Lord is our strength, especially in times when we feel weak. So trust Him. May we strive together to experience the amazing joy that is offered for those who follow Christ. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for what you have given us in your Son, Jesus. There is no greater gift. And on top of that, you have poured out your blessings to give us so many gifts that point to you, Jesus. Thank you for the gift of material provision, for the gift of family and friendship, for the gift of the body of Christ. Thank you for your word. Thank you for all that you've given us, Lord. I pray for those who are struggling right now. I pray that you would comfort them, that you would send your Spirit, and that you would provide peace and joy through whatever dark, difficult times they are facing. Lord, I pray that we would be bold in inviting other people into the light, out of the darkness, so that more people may know who you are, Jesus, and may have deep, everlasting joy. Lord, help us to shine your light more. Father, hear us now as we close this prayer out by praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.